Join me in the call to worship. We begin a journey today with God, its companion and destination.
We come as worshipers, lifting our voices in praise.
We begin a journey today with Jesus, its story and call.
We come as disciples, opening our lives to transformation.
We begin a journey today with Spirit, its presence and possibility.
We come as seekers, entering our Lenten wilderness time with hope.
Let us pray. God of love and mercy, we gather today from different places, both of location and life experience. Some of us arrive content, others muddled and fractured, still others somewhere in between. In trust, we ask that you hold us in your grace. God of love and mercy, at the beginning of this Lenten season, we pray for a willingness to be held in all that we are. We come daring to believe that in your embrace, joy and hope arises anew. In thanksgiving, we ask that you hold us in your grace. Amen. Let's join in singing, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above, found in the Blue Hymnal 483.
Thank you.
We are called to confession. Like a parent, God seeks to set boundaries for the children of God. And like children, we are stubborn enough to want to do things our own way. So we become easy prey for the evil one. But Jesus, our brother, shows us how to find the will and the strength to resist and to know the mercy of God. Together, let us confess our sins so God might fill us with hope and joy as we pray together, saying, God of Eden's morning, we know that Lent is a hard time for us. In a culture which showcases success, you call us to sacrifice ourselves for others. In a world which promotes power, you invite us to deny ourselves. In a society which encourages us to feel good, you point us to the struggles of our sisters, to the burdens our brothers bear. By your mercy, forgive us, hope of our lives. Remind us that as we journey with Jesus, we learn the steps of discipleship. As we listen to his call to obedience, may we learn how to say no to all that tempts us. As we see his suffering, may we live out the good news in which has come to us through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, in this time of silence, please take a few moments for your own private confession. Friends, in the mystery of God, we are held and honored. We are welcomed into a circle of love that is ever widening, expanding to include all that we are and all that is. Through God's love and grace, we are forgiven.
Today is a song of praise based on Psalm 19. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard, yet their voice goes out through all the world.
Sky to close the day, I wade the surf where dolphins play. The taste of salt, the dance of waves, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. A lightning flash, my pounding heart, a breaching whale, a shooting star. Give testimony that you are, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise God all his mighty works. There is no language where you can't be heard. your song goes out to all the earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. O created moon and sparrow's wings, O thunder's boom and Saturn's rings, unveil our Father as you sing, and the soul wells up with hallelujah. Oh, praise God all his mighty works. There is no language where you can't be heard. Your song goes out to all the earth. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Of life within my wrist, a fallen snow, a rising mist. There is no higher praise than this, and my soul wells up, oh my soul wells up, yes my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise God all his mighty works. There is no language where you can't be heard. Your song goes out to all the earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
God, our hiding place, as your word is heard and preached, guide our thoughts, rekindle our hopes, and give birth to renewed possibility. Amen. Scripture this morning is found in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Well, then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. Thanks be to God. Please join me in the responsive reading. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all ye who are upright in heart.
Ash Wednesday, this past Wednesday, begins the season of Lent. Lent is the acronym that my friend Tom Schumann came up for let's eat nothing tasty. Looking at the lectionary readings for Lent, some of them reminded me of years back when I taught confirmation class, and we did the three G's, a trio of connected lessons covering guilt, grace, and gratitude. Guilt, grace, gratitude, the three G's. We use the word guilt, so the G fit in with the other two G's, but what we're really talking about here is sin. For all the confessing we do in worship each week, and I gotta tell you, when I start confirmation classes way back when, and we just talk about the worship service, and I say, you know, what do you remember about worship? Confession. Because they were used to leaving right after the confession to go to children's Sunday school or whatever, and so that was as much as they got. But anyway, for all the confessing we do week by week, we don't actually talk a whole lot about sin. So what is sin? There too, each confirmation class always seemed to have some topic that they like just got hung up on. And even after the topic was passed, they'd circle back around to it because they're like, they still don't get it. One year it was the Trinity, the three in one, and I, believe me, with you all, I've already told you many times, I give it my best shot, but that's a hard one to explain. But another year, the topic was sin. We talked about sin, we moved on, and kept coming back. What is sin? What is this sin? The Hebrew word for sin is to be separated from God. Anything that separates us from God. Or another way of saying it is anything that gets between us and God. Following Jesus' time alone in the wilderness with challenges and temptations, it's fitting that we also take a walk in the garden, the first place in the Bible where we get separated from our God. Listen to the passage from Genesis. Yahweh God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And Yahweh God commanded Adam, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." Skipping to chapter 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that Yahweh God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees of the garden, But God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, do you find this to be true? Life is so busy. Oh my goodness. Taking a 40-day wilderness sabbatical for Lent, like Jesus did, is out of the question. There's just no time for it. Gospels say that the Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness. Mark says it was more like the Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness. Jesus needed to get there just like we needed. And then there's the garden, which is as alien to us as another planet. Maybe the Spirit needs to lead us, or even drive us, into the wilderness and garden for just this brief moment, in the hopes that it will somehow reconnect us to our Creator, who is still creating, even in the chaos of today's world. To reconnect us. We need reconnecting. Time and again, we get separated from God by our sin. We are all guilty of that. We'd like to think not so. We're good people, we follow the laws and we do what's right. I'm preaching to the choir, aren't I? I mean, here you all are in worship, yes? But then there's this lovely line Paul writes to the Romans in chapter 3, verse 23. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's no getting around it. All. Even our goodness or striving for goodness can be what gets between us and God. If goodness becomes the goal instead of right living with God. The first man and woman lived closely with God. God gives them freedom of the new creation, even shares the creating process by having the first human name all the other species. The freedom God gives, ordains, is expansive, but it's not boundless. There are limits to the exercise of our creaturely freedom. So along comes the serpent. To question those limits. The serpent, we're told it's cunning, crafty, shrewd, but it is not evil, contrary to popular belief. The serpent is part of the creation that God calls good. The serpent also is not a villain, but a neutral observer of the God-human relationship. It becomes a facilitator of temptation as the conversation progresses. It raises the question about the amount of freedom God has given humans. The issue at the deepest level, though, is trust. Is the giver of the prohibition not to eat the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, is this one who can be trusted with their best interest? The serpent questions God's motivation, that it might be more focused on God than on their welfare. Can humans trust that God has their best interests at heart, even if they don't know everything? Can we trust that God will be able to discern that not all that we call benefits are in our best interests? The serpent subtly insinuates that it is out of jealousy that God limits our freedom and forbids our enlightenment. Over against such divine tyranny, you owe it to yourselves to resist, it implies. Think for yourself, act for yourself, Don't let anyone, even God, define for you what is good and evil. Again, it's all about choices. Long before Moses implored the Israelites to choose life, humankind had a bigger choice. Who do we choose to believe? The God who created us in love, or the worldly voices telling us to figure it out for ourselves, to rely on our own resources, to make our own way in the world, to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps? I really don't like that last one. Good choices require some time to think about what we're doing. The woman actually took time to reflect. She and the man together had thought about the command concerning the knowledge of good and evil tree. She knew what the command was, and perhaps out of anxiety to not disobey, she takes it even further. They're not supposed to eat it, or they're not supposed to touch it. God didn't say that part. Likewise, after the serpent has asked questions, she takes a good long look at the tree. She, or they together, evaluated its benefits. As a food source, its pleasing attributes, its desire for wisdom. Then the decision was made to take and eat. The problem is, she left one thing out of her evaluation: God and her relationship with God. She didn't think of the consequences of her actions. Sound familiar? The garden may be foreign territory to us, but our inclination to make our own decisions using our criteria and leaving God out of the equation is very familiar to all of us. Why should God care what I do? So what if I drive a little over the speed limit, or cheat a bit on my taxes, or fail to call my child or parent? It's not hurting anyone else, so why should it matter? I don't need God to decide, you know, what car to buy, or what town to live in, or where to work, or who to marry. Every decision we make on our own separates us from God. Every time we say, to heck with the consequences, I'm going to do what I want for a change, we've chosen to put something else between us and God. The first 11 chapters of the book of Genesis show over and over the results of sin, the results of our independent choices. And those results are broken relationships. First, the relationship between God and humans is broken. Then between man and woman, between the brothers Cain and Abel. Further on, the flood separating people from creation. And finally, after the Tower of Babel falls, the people are broken into nations in conflict with one another. And thus we have the brokenness of today's world. Jesus, in the wilderness, shows us another way. In the face of the most basic of human temptations, physical needs, fame, power, Jesus stays firmly connected with God. With the voice of his baptism ringing in his ears, he says, "This is who I am, and not that which you're saying to me." He chooses to keep God in the center of his decision-making. In the most stressful of times, when he is physically spent and exhausted, Jesus still resists defining what his own best interests are. And Jesus doesn't define what ours are, but instead he shows us that it's possible to lean on God for that defining. Like it or not, we all make bad choices. We all sin. We're all guilty. The good news is that not even sin can ultimately separate us from God's love. We just need to trust God with our choices, big and little. We need to resist impulse. Okay, that one's being preached to me. We need to resist impulse and take time to think about God and consequences. That takes some time getting to know God.
It takes some time for reflection, both before we need to choose and when we need to choose. Don't have 40 days for a spiritual retreat? Not even 40 hours? Yeah, probably not. How about 40 minutes? Or even just 4 minutes to be in God's presence and to ponder with God the decisions before you each day. I close with a poem from Reverend Timothy Hott called Holy Encounters. We come, all of us, to the land of broken dreams. We do not choose to be here. Yesterday, the sun was shining, the radio was playing a rakish tune as we hurried down the highway. Today, the music has stopped, and only a lonely wind whistles through the hollows of our heart. We cry for help, turn to run for home, but the road is gone. And then something holy happens. A small bird sings. A single shaft of light drenches the morning. We feel a hand in ours. It is you, God. You've gone ahead into this land, and you're already there, waiting. Surprise us with your bread and angels. Open our eyes to see your footprints everywhere. Amen. We're using the red hymnal for our second hymn. It's number 57, Cleanse Me. And if you're a musical person, there's some notes above the melody, so please don't let that throw you.
affirmation of faith, which comes from Romans 8. We believe there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. We are convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. For our prayer today, we are sharing a litany for Lent, and that'll be on the PowerPoint. It is in the bulletin, and I'm realizing I missed some bolding in this. Sorry for bad formatting on my part. Let us be in prayer. O Christ, led by the Spirit to wander temptation's wilderness, you show us how to turn our backs on the wrong ways of the world so we can follow you faithfully. Walk with us, Lord Jesus. O Christ, wellspring of wonder, you let go of your glory so you might hold our shattered hearts. Cradle us, Lord Jesus. O Christ, graceful and truthful, you empty yourself to fill us with a bread which makes us whole, with the living waters which burst the banks of our faded dreams. Fill us, Lord Jesus. O Christ, shatterer of sin's death grip, into our despair you bring hope. In our fear you come with peace. In our loneliness you become our brother. Save us, Lord Jesus. Jesus Christ, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, pour out your grace upon us. Jesus Christ, gift of salvation, grant us your peace. Take time now for your silent prayers. Gardener of grace, you hold nothing, nothing back from us. Your very self came to us. Your very heart was broken for us. Your very life was poured out for us in Jesus, our brother, our Savior. We seek to do your will, to share your truth, to sing of your faithfulness, to proclaim the good news as we follow Jesus into the wonder of your kingdom. God and community, holy in one, gather our hearts now as we gather our voices to pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Again, I welcome Lynn Newbrander, who is here from International Students, Inc. This is our mission focus for the month, and Lynn's with us to tell us what's happening with International Students, and welcome to Lynn. I should say welcome to Lynn, but I always look at the laptop and end up doing that. Go for it, Lynn.
Good morning. It's just wonderful to be with you. I'm here in my home in Philadelphia because we couldn't get away this weekend. We have a very special friend here for her birthday, so we stayed here. And she's sitting next to me, actually. She's from India. And I just am really grateful for your support and your prayers that make our ministry possible to international students. As all of you know, God is bringing the nations to us. So that we can minister to all kinds of people from all over the world. Tim and I also have different students who have lived with us in the past. We've had almost 100 students live with us, so that's been a privilege as well. But our ministry primarily focuses on four different areas. And the first one is that we seek to serve students. So we seek to serve them by helping them when they first arrive, taking them shopping, show them around Philadelphia, get them acclimated, to help them get furniture. Sometimes we give furniture. If we have it, we give it, and collect it from others to give to them. And we also serve them by just being family, home away from home. You know, they're a long way from home, and all the other students go off and see their families for their vacations, but international students are here and they're lonesome for their families. So Tim and I love being a surrogate mom or dad for these students. We also teach them to serve by offering them service opportunities. So for example, we've packed packages for guests at the Ronald McDonald House, or we've taken students and had them help out cleaning or getting things ready for a crisis pregnancy center, or making packages for people in relief, different ways that students have to serve. And often students are jumping up and helping and going and helping this person move or that person move. So we even have students who help us get set up for Friday nights. We also want to meet their social needs. You know, life in America should be fun. And so we like to provide lots of opportunities to celebrate. We love to have birthdays together with students. Last night we went out and celebrated. The reason our friend is here is it's her birthday. And or we like to go to a movie together, or we'll just take time to celebrate their country. Coming up for us this month, next month, is a Celebrate Africa Night, where we're going to celebrate particularly our African students. We've had a Lunar New Year party and a Celebrate India party, so we're going to take a time to celebrate our African students. We do those kinds of celebrations in big groups and in small groups. Sometimes the big groups are, we have about 100 people. We meet in a local church that has given us their space. And then the smaller events, up to about 40 or 45, they can be accommodated in our home. A little bit squishing. It's a little tight, but you know, the more the merrier. And then, or we'll go someplace together, have coffee together, do different things. We also naturally are here to meet students' spiritual needs, because students are interested and curious about how God would relate to their lives. We have students from all different backgrounds. A student with me today is a Hindu. We have Buddhist students. We have students who have no belief at all, Muslim students, all different ones. And we want to share the love of Jesus with them. And one of the ways that we do that is every Friday night we meet in our home. So we set up tables and kind of deconstruct the house a little bit by moving furniture around. And then we have a dinner. So lots of cooking. If you love international students, it's good to have lots of food. Everybody's hungry. And then we go upstairs and we have a brief introduction. Then we break up for a Bible discussion. And this particular semester, our Bible discussion is on the topic of rest and how God offers rest to us. And of course, the greatest rest that we can have is to rest from our good works and from all the things we try to do, and to receive his forgiveness. We also are there to develop leadership. So Tim and I meet with our student leaders. We have one guy from two from China and one from Niger in Africa. And we meet with them every other week and have been teaching them how to facilitate the Bible discussions and how to take leadership in contacting students and reaching out to them. And there are, in addition to that, we have small group Bible studies and different things like that. But we really would not be here if it weren't for all of you all. And so we're deeply, deeply grateful for your partnership with us. And I'm also thankful that the pandemic brought us all this possibility of coming together on Zoom, where we wouldn't be able to do that. We look forward to seeing you in the future, and we would like to just extend our gratitude. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lynn. It was wonderful to have you with us by Zoom. And again, I'm looking at the laptop instead of the camera.
I forgot to say that Tim was not able to come this morning. He has responsibilities, but he also sends his greetings and wanted to be remembered to all of you. You could see him on our little picture. So.
Wonderful, wonderful. And blessings to him as well, as he's off doing other things that he needs to be doing.
Thank you.
This is a marvelous ministry. I love that there's the Montrose connection, because the New Branders have the connection up here. And it's personal
They're one of us that's doing this ministry down in Philadelphia to international students. So this is great. And so just so happy to have Lynn with us today to learn more about that. And again, the International Students Inc. is our mission focus for February. Today's the last Sunday of that. So just lift them up in prayer, please. Let us give as each is able, according to the blessings God has given us. Held securely by your love, we seek to be an offering of love to the world and to have our spirits wing free to live again. Receive the gifts of our hands and the desires of our hearts, using each in your unfolding ways. Amen. Our last hymn is in the blue hymnal again, number 81, Lord, Who Throughout These 40 Days.
Thank you.
friends, hidden in the deep mercy of God, further opened by the friendship of Christ, and inflamed by the encouragement of the Spirit, go into this new day and season, alive to yourself and others, and awake to the possibilities of love. Amen.